Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bih. Wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyi'ati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lah wa man yudlil fala hadiya lah. Wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan 'abduhu wa rasuluh. Amma ba'du faqala Allah ta'ala Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu attaqullaha haqqa tuqatih wa la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun Ya ayyuhal nasu attaqu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahida wa khalaqa minha zawjaha wa batha minhuma rijalan kathiran wa nisaa wa attaqullaha alladhi tasa'aluna bihi wal arham inna allaha kana alaykum raqiba يا ايها الذين امنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم اعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما فان اصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى واحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الامور محدثاتها وكل محدثه بدعه وكل بدعه ضلاله وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي My dear brothers and sisters, one of my teachers narrated an event that took place in his life. He said that he was living in Medina, studying over there. And one day he woke up and he found his wife crying. Tears were rolling down her eyes. And he said that as soon as I saw her, it occurred to me that perhaps her father had passed away. And he asked her, he said, "Is it your father?" And she said, "No." He said, "Then why are you crying?" She said, Sheikh bin Baz, rahimahullah, passed away. And he said that on that day, there was a radio show that this radio show host used to host Sheikh bin Baz on the radio and ask him questions that Sheikh bin Baz would answer. And today, the job of this radio show host was to announce the death of bin Baz, rahimahullah. And of course, as you can imagine, that he was not able to make that announcement and he broke down. And he said on that day, every masjid in that country and many, many masajid across the world, they spoke about bin Baz rahimahullah and they announced the news. And anyone who had any idea of appreciation of knowledge would break down while announcing the news when it would come to the time of mentioning the name of who has passed away. My dear brothers and sisters, when people of knowledge pass away, it is a huge calamity for the Ummah. To the point that the greatest calamity that ever occurred to this Ummah was the passing away of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the famous story about Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and Umar radiallahu anhu after a few days after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Bakr said to Umar, "Let's go and visit Ummu Ayman." Ummu Ayman radiallahu anha was the mother figure of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who had raised him from childhood. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr and Umar accompanying him used to go and visit Ummu Ayman and talk with her just like anyone would visit his mother. So after a few days of the passing of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Bakr said to Umar, "Let's go and visit Ummu Ayman the way the Prophet used to visit." So as soon as they entered upon Ummu Ayman, tears started rolling down her eyes. And she broke down crying. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said that, "Why are you crying when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is in a better place now? His pain, his test, his difficulties that he had to go through are now over. So why are you crying? You should be celebrating that Alhamdulillah that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, everyone has to go, but he's not suffering anymore. He's not going through these difficult trials that he went through anymore. His sickness is over. And Ummu Ayman radiallahu anha said that I am not crying because the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam passed away. I am crying because the revelation will not come to us anymore. The way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would communicate to humanity was through the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And now that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has passed, we do not have that door to communicate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that way anymore. My dear brothers and sisters, our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to lift knowledge, He doesn't lift knowledge by erasing the books. But knowledge is lifted through the death of the people of knowledge. Because, subhanAllah, let's face it, every single book, or almost every single book that you can think of, is now available on your fingertips. With just a few clicks, you can have the largest Hadith library at your fingertips, and tafsir library, and fiqh library. You can search through them. You don't even have to go through the index anymore that you used to have to do in the back, in the past, where you'd have to look up a topic in the index. The index itself used to be like 40, 50 pages. And you would find a term there, and it would mention that this topic is mentioned on this page, and this page, and this page, and this page, and this page. And you would start from the first one, and you would look through each one of those pages if it mentions the topic or the actual aspect that you are worried about. Now, you don't have to do that anymore. You have all of that. But subhanAllah, even while we have all of these books, which one of us knows how to read these books properly? Which one of us knows how to understand them properly? Which one of us knows what the scholar meant? Although we have the books, but we don't have the understanding. And that understanding is in the minds of the people of knowledge. And when a person of knowledge passes away, at that time you realize how much of the knowledge has left. When Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu passed away, the Sahaba, they said that Umar radiallahu anhu took 90% of knowledge with him. The things that he understood, and we all know the impact of Umar ibn Khattab until today. Every single time when you pass by the highway rest stop, and you're like, you know what, thank God they have this rest stop so I can go and use the bathroom. I can stop my car for a little bit, walk around, stretch my legs. I can get something from the vending machine. This was actually started by Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. And so many other things that until today, the system of mail reaching you, while you not having to travel to deliver that letter, but you can go take it to an office and deliver that mail, and that will travel on your behalf to other parts of the world and be delivered to the person. This was also started by Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, because he understood the wisdom and the need for these things. But when he passed away, they said that he took with him 90% of knowledge. And every single time a scholar passes away, we have no guarantee that there is someone else who knows what he knows. When the great scholar Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib rahimahullah passed away, Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, I'm sorry, Sa'id ibn Jubair rahimahullah, when he passed away, Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he said that there isn't a single person on this earth who needs the knowledge that Sa'id ibn Jubair has. We all need what we did not, we don't have that opportunity anymore when a person of knowledge passes away. My dear brothers and sisters, the story that I told you about of the sheikh who came and saw his wife crying is the story of Sheikh Muhammad Alshareef, who himself passed away yesterday. And many of you will probably see on Facebook people mentioning who he was and what he has done. And one of the things that everyone is saying is that every single one of us living in the West has been impacted by his work, whether we know it or not. The simple fact that we have a camera in the masjid that broadcasts our program was something that was unheard of before the time of Sheikh Muhammad Alshareef coming back to America. The fact that when you have a program in a masjid and you make a nice, beautiful flyer, this flyer making idea of a nice flyer was done by none other than Sheikh Muhammad Alshareef. Before that, it used to be that a simple flyer with words that says that Sheikh so-and-so will be teaching the book so-and-so. And if you were really, really keen on learning, you would be reading that flyer. Otherwise, it would be just, you know, I have seen people, I've seen the evolution of flyers. And you, if you were to have a time stamp on those flyers, you would see that from the time that he came onto the scene, you started to see color. You started to see beautiful graphics. That when you see that, you're like, wow, what is that? And now all of that is standard. Not only that, there were so many other things that he introduced that every single, you know, one of the shuyukh, he said that every single institute in America right now, in the West, and even in the East, that is teaching Islamic knowledge, has copied some idea of this one man. That he was the brains behind all of this. So last night I was watching this one sheikh who knew him and who knew his father. And he said that one time he was in Hajj with this man and his father. And he said to his father, Sheikh Muhammad al-Sharif's father, he said that your son has a secret. That there are people that are far more knowledgeable than him. But he is loved more than them. There are people who are far more experienced than him. But he has more acceptance in the hearts of the people in terms of the work that he does than those people. There must be a secret behind what made him like this. What made Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from him his work that he's reaching so far and wide. So his father said, I will tell you what that secret is. He said that when Muhammad was a teenager, and they used to live in Winnipeg, Canada, North Canada, very cold. He said that me and him, we used to go at 3 or 4 a.m. in the morning in minus 30, minus 40 degrees Fahrenheit. And the roads are snowed, the masjid is snowed. And he said that we used to go before Fajr and we used to open the way to the masjid by cleaning up the snow at 3, 4 a.m. in minus 30, minus 40 degrees. So the sheikh said, you know what? That's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has opened a way for him. Because he opened the way for the people to come to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear brothers and sisters, it really is sad for anyone who appreciates Islamic knowledge to hear about any person of knowledge passing away. But yes, we can all feel sad and we can all feel that grief and we can shed some tears. But the question is, what will we do about that? One of the things that occurred to me yesterday, but I didn't say it, but I heard another sheikh mention it. He said that when people die, when people of knowledge, when they die, especially when they die young, this man was only 47 years old, that it is perhaps because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saving them from a fitna that is coming later. And he said, it scares us to think about what could be coming next that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved this person from. And then subhanAllah, what happens in the time of fitna is that you look for the people of knowledge. You look towards them to help, to guide you as to what should be done. And then you find that they're not there. This is a scary thought. My dear brothers and sisters, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward this man for what he has done. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from him all of his good deeds. Indeed, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when a person dies, if the people of the earth say good things about him, the angels write those down. And if the people of the earth say bad things about him, the angels write those down as well. His reputation in the heavens is judged by his reputation on earth. But again, whoever is gone is gone, and every one of us will have to go one day. But the question is that now that we feel, and every single time a scholar passes away, you know, this is not about a personality, this is not about one person, but every single time a scholar passes away, we, the Ummah, need to understand that this is a very serious problem for us. And we need to do something to replace what has been lost. Or at least try to do so. Like if you imagine that there is a bridge, and when a flood comes, and the power of that water hits the pillars of this bridge, we all know and understand that these pillars will become weaker and weaker and weaker. So when that flood passes, engineers will go and they will assess the damage that has been done. And they will add more reinforcement to build it back up to the level that it was before. Because if we don't build it back up, then the next flood will come, will make it even weaker. And the next flood might actually bring the bridge down. So my dear brothers and sisters, today I want to ask you all, what are you doing to replenish the knowledge which is being lost? Of course, the scholars are dying, and they will keep dying until there won't be any left. But those of us who are living, we need to make some investments, investments of our time, investments of our money, and the biggest investment, the investment of our young people. I know that every single parent is always worried about them, their child having a good life. So they want to educate them in the best universities. They will pay for after-school tuition programs in order to make sure that they get good grades so they can get into a good university. They will tell them, look, you don't have to worry about money. You don't have to worry about rent. You don't have to worry about gas. We will give it to you all. We are making an investment in you. Just focus on your studies so that once you graduate, you can get a good job and you can have a good life. And we would feel that we did not leave you on the road. But my dear brothers and sisters, what are we doing for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How many of us are willing to talk to our children and encourage them and inspire them by people like Sheikh Muhammad Alshareef and others, that you know what, look at the legacy that he left behind. But now somebody needs to pick up that legacy where he left off and take it to the next level. But so many of us are not willing to make this sacrifice. We think that if we choose the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the path of protecting the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then our children will die hungry. But subhanallah, you look at the lives of the scholars in the past, that the scholars had more respect in society than the most powerful people of that land. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never takes away something from you, except that he gives it to you in so many more folds. So my dear brothers and sisters, what can you do to make this investment, to replenish what has been lost? Ali ibn al-Aasim, he says that his father said to him, here is 100,000 dirhams. Here is 100,000 dirhams. Take this and replace them with 100,000 ahadith. meaning take this money and go and study with the scholars and come back to me when you have memorized 100,000 ahadith. My dear brothers and sisters, the most common questions that imams and shuyukh get are things like, is McDonald's halal? Can we buy meat from the supermarket? Is this cheese halal? Can I wear these clothes? Can I go to a party at work where alcohol is being served? But we wish that we had the imams. We wish that we had people asking, what is my obligation in seeking knowledge? What is that I have to do at a minimum to make sure that I fulfill my obligation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to fulfill the role that we have towards protecting our deen? My dear brothers and sisters, Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah, he says that it is fard on every single Muslim to learn the basics of wudu and salah. It is fard on every single Muslim to understand in proper detail the pillars of iman, you know, belief in Allah, His angels, His books, the last day, the divine decree. It is fard upon every single one of us to have a very good, healthy understanding of these principles. Our wudu and salah, fasting in the month of Ramadan, to understand how to give zakah properly. And then he says that these are what is required for everyone, every single Muslim. And then he says, if you are involved in business, then it is required for you to understand the fiqh of transactions. What is halal and what is haram? Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu famously used to go to the markets and he would quiz the merchants who had set up shop. And he would tell them that if I give you this and ask you to give me this back, is this halal or not? And if the person gave the wrong answer, he would basically make him shut down his store. And he would say, go to the masjid and learn about the rules of transactions and interest. Because if you don't know it, you will engage in it. If you don't know it, you will engage in it. Not only that, my dear brothers and sisters, we also have a crisis in marriage. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us, but we are going towards a bad situation. You probably saw, and inshallah we'll talk more about it in the future, that a man, a Muslim man, travels hundreds of miles and goes and kills his ex-wife or his wife. And this is not something that's happened the first time. It's happening again and again. Where this is not the teaching of our deen. Our deen says that hold them in good or let them go in good. Live with them happy or leave happy. But we have so much ignorance which is compounded by our emotion and arrogance that we are having so many cases in the Muslim community of things like domestic violence. But Ibn al-Jawzi would say that before you get married, you're required to get educated about marriage. What are your rights? What are your obligations? And every single one of us knows everything about our rights. But when it comes to our obligations, that's where we are lacking. He would say that if you happen to be a physician, then you need to learn the rules of medicine in Islam. What are Islamic guidelines with regards to treatment? What is okay, what is not okay? Then that becomes a specific obligation on you. So my dear brothers and sisters, we get pumped up and we feel sad when scholars pass away. But I'm reminding myself first and foremost and all of us that we need to be looking towards our younger people, younger generation, and we need to encourage them to go into the field of knowledge in order to replenish what has been damaged by the flood. Because if we don't do that, we will come upon a time that used to be before, that we will come upon a time when it would be difficult for a person to find someone who they can ask some of the basic questions about Islam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all the tawfiq to do our role in the replenishment of knowledge in the Ummah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give our scholars long lives. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect them from falling into fitan. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the tawfiq to benefit from them and have more scholars in the next generation than we had in the last generation. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala al-Nabi. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina wa maulana Muhammadin nabiyika wa abdika wa rasulik. Allahumma salli alayhi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa azwajihi wa dhurriyatihi ajma'in wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsanin ila yawmiddin. Wa qala rabbukum ud'uni astajib lakum innal ladhina yastakbiruna an ibadati sayadkhuluna jahannama dakhirin. Allahumma rabbana taqabbal minna innaka anta as-sami'ul alim wa tub alayna innaka anta at-tawwabur rahim. Allahumma rabbana atina fid dunya hasanah wa fil akhirati hasanah wa qina adhaban nar. اللهم اغفر لي حينا وميتنا وشاهدنا وغائبنا وصغيرنا وكبيرنا وذكرنا وأنثانا. اللهم من أحييته منا فأحيه على الإسلام ومن توفيته منا فتوفه على الإيمان. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. أقيموا الصلاة.